Good evening, everybody. I have to say, maybe that I'm sorry that we didn't announce it explicitly, that the kickoff, the opening of the School for Politics and Critique, will be only in English tonight. That was in order to spare time and to have more direct exchange with the participants of the region tonight. It is a great pleasure to me, and basically I'm a little bit excited to see so many people coming out tonight, especially for a school like that, which is all out in red. It is a kind of a sign, we know from previous events and things that we've done. It is a sign that a certain sort of mourning among the generation which was born and raised in a period for transition, which has inflicted on us so much despair. Finally, that period of mourning is coming to an end, and I think that slowly we start to seek some political alternatives to this period of devastation that we have suffered. It is a good way to start with. As most of you know, it is intended to boost the capacity and knowledge of left-wing activists in Macedonia on a range of issues from leftist politics, alternatives, initiatives, to Marxist theory and revolutionary praxis. The school will be organized, as you know, methodologically of seminars, two-day seminars per month, because we had our annual conference and we had budget plan for the conference and for the schools, and for the school we felt sorry to bring him twice from London in 1 month, so we decided to have the opening tonight. But be aware that the other seminars will be taking place during weekends in the following months. It is my pleasure tonight to welcome Richard Seymour, journalist, columnist of The Guardian, one of the largest newspapers in the UK. He's also a political activist, now with the Left Unity. It's a new left initiative and political formation in the UK. And also an author and publisher of several books. Tonight's topic that we're going to talk about is the perspectives of the left in Europe. And we thought of this issue, of this topic, to be the opening of the school in order for us to get a perspective of what are the political dynamics of the left in Europe, in order to kind of have a wider perspective while we try to find our political alternatives, to find our ways and means inside our country. Welcome, Richard. Thank you for coming along. Well, we would start the conversation, since we this conversation as the perspectives of the European left. Can we start off with a brief description of what can be today considered as the left, political left, in Europe, being aware constantly of the diversities that exist within different formations across Europe, but maybe can we give a sort of a general frame of the politics which we might consider leftist politics?
Okay, well, here we go. I think before answering that question, there's a general framework that we have to get in mind, and that is the crisis of the left. 2008 and the recession, the credit crunch, and everything that followed from that has not just been a crisis of capitalism, as we're used to hearing, but most importantly, for our purposes, it's also a crisis of the left. And if you're a materialist, if you're a Marxist in any way, I don't know if everyone here is, but if you are, then I think that logically follows. I think you would expect that the institutions of the left, being embedded in the social formations that are affected by crisis, would themselves be thrown into crisis. So there's three ways in which this might present itself, which partly answers your question just by talking about it. First, it sharpens and throws into relief the dimension crisis which already befell the left. So it's not just a conjunctural crisis, it's a structural crisis. Three ways. First of all, the traditional social democratic left has been losing its base. Across the board, it's been losing its connection with its voting base, which has been fragmenting off in various different directions for about 30 years now. It has been losing its ideological distinctiveness as it has been colonized by neoliberal ideology and practices. It has been losing its historic sort of repertoire of tactics and strategies. In other words, the social democracy has been the major form in which leftist politics has been expressed in the continent, and it currently has no ability to answer, to analyze or explain the current crisis of capitalism, or to propose any solutions other than milder versions of the austerity remedies that the parties of the right have been pushing. So that's social democracy. Then there's the old communist parties, aging, very subcultural, you know, they're not the kinds of routines and rituals that they're interested in are the kinds of things that don't interest particularly newer generations of leftists. They're very conservative tactically, generally speaking politically far more moderate than their rhetoric and their formal ideological commitments would allow. Two examples where communists actually got into government, Cyprus and Moldova. I mean, did you see any serious challenge to market-based politics, to neoliberalism? I don't think so. So you see these parties also experiencing a secular long-term decline, not just a decline in their formal substantive politics, but a decline in their ability to relate to a wider audience in most cases. And the various remedies adopted to fix that, Eurocommunism being one of them, did nothing really except accelerate and accentuate the crisis. Okay, then there's the far left, the various parties of the revolutionary left, which more or less most of them thrived since the 1960s, at least I think in Western Europe, and in the context of the revolutions in Southern Europe, but also just general tumult in Northwestern Europe too. And these organizations have singularly failed to respond effectively to the crisis of capitalism. They failed, I think, largely because they did not, I mean, I'm not going to, I'm speaking in a very general way here, so I don't know if one can speak about every Trotskyist or Maoist or revolutionary left formation in this way, but in general, I think they failed because their analysis of capitalism and neoliberalism was not up to date, it was not up to speed. That in order to preserve their ideological purity and rectitude, all too often they refused to face up to certain changes that were taking place in the composition of the working class, in the way in which capitalism was organized. And so you had a sort of defense of treasured orthodoxies rather than an attempt to face up to realities. They started with the good old things rather than the bad new things, the opposite of Brexit advice. So there's three sort of sectors of the left, all of them in crisis. I mentioned the crisis of the far left, I just want to specify something. The crisis of the far left is very particular to the Anglophone far left. Now, I don't know much beyond that, but there's a very particular element of it in the Anglophone. Some of you will already know, with failure on other forms of politics, such as gender politics. Again, the refusal to incorporate and understand the contribution of feminist movements was a largely defensive and reactive posture, an attempt to sort of conserve the purity of a Marxist commitment, and that has come back in a way, in a seriously destructive way now. And they are historically at a loss as a result. And this fragmentation, by the way, is happening in several organisations, not just the Socialist Works Party, but
it seems like with the crisis, I think it's fine. With the crisis of the left, during the times of crisis of the left, which corresponds to the crisis, the economic crisis throughout Europe, there has been a kind of movement which has come out of this crisis, which is not in crisis, and which is spreading as a strategy, as an occurrence throughout Europe, and these are the social movements. I mean, Indignados, taking the model of Occupy, and in your articles you have said that this, you have written that this movement, social movements have not succeeded to win even a to inflict a single damage on austerity. And you've kind of pointed out the limitations of these social movements, which only focus on kicking off and resisting and advocating for broader alliances. Could you at least describe the context in which these social movements appear, and in particular their kind of allergy or being alienated from political parties and having kind of very bad attitudes towards aligning with certain structures from left or the far left?
Yeah, well, this is why I get called pessimistic. Look, the thing about historic social movements that have been successful, I don't know if you want to think about the anti-Vietnam War movement, the civil rights movement. I'm sorry, my examples are going to be largely American-based because that's where my area of study is. But if you look at them, what you find is that there is something that present-day social movements actually lack, and that is an infrastructure. They don't have any infrastructure. I mean, that's an overstatement, obviously. There are forms of organization. There are ways in which people stay in touch and pull together large numbers of people and raise money and produce publicity and so on. But there's a real etiolation, sorry, that's an obscure word. There's a real breakdown of the institutions that have traditionally been able to sustain social movements. A breakdown of political parties, a breakdown of in the wake of neoliberalism, and even of things like churches. I mean, the traditional role of churches. I know it's different in Macedonia, but certainly the traditional role of churches in the United States and being able to mobilize people is even that is run down to some extent. So there's, and it doesn't apply in the United Kingdom really to any significant extent. So what you get is pathological symptoms. There's two ways in which this comes out. One is the NGOization of left-wing politics. That is, you get small groups of people who are very media savvy and who are sort of tightly knit and reasonably well organized. Or the big if, I don't know if you've heard about this. And it's a social movement, but they simulate the appearance of one. They have celebrity sort of telebroadcasts and advertisements, and they create a big kerfuffle. And then there's a big glorious day of reckoning, which everybody meets in a big park, and there's a rock concert, and they have a big orgasmic explosion of, everything. It's happening. And then they go home, apparently satisfied with this, and nothing has changed, This is, this is one of the pathological symptoms, but you get this with certain kinds of left-wing group as well. The other is this sort of anti-political sort of tendency. I mean, I don't think that one should be sectarian about this. On the other hand, I'm going to be. On the other hand, I think that there is an element of it being a pathology of defeat and fragmentation. That is to say, given the historic collapse of any attempt to form a kind of genuinely democratic form of organization which can fuse significant sections of the population, concentrate their interests in a political form, help lead a struggle, and so on. Given that every single attempt has either failed in ignominy or has resulted in some sort of bizarre bureaucratic distortion, then logically there's an element of giving up. There's an element of people saying, "What the hell with that?" We don't need that level of organization. We can rely on people's individual initiative, and somehow, out of interaction, our collective interaction, hopefully through the internet, you know, this is another fetish that's coming about now, mediated by the internet, we will spontaneously generate the types of organization that we need. And I feel, I feel that one should foreground the way in which this overlaps with a kind of neoliberal ideology. And the central claim that neoliberalism makes is that we do not need, in fact, the last thing we need is any kind of planned social organization. This necessarily leads to tyranny. It leads to inefficiency and distortion. Therefore, what we need is to allow the spontaneous order of the market to do its job. And if you can create market-like structures in every area of life, from the government to the internet to wherever, if people interact on that basis and somehow information is spontaneously accumulated and sent out again in signals a bit like price signals, you know. So on Twitter you have your trending topics, your hashtags and what have you. These are almost like price signals. They tell you what's hot and what's not. Well, this is kind of, there's a certain overlap there. There's a way in which people can end up rationalizing the very irrelevance, the very powerlessness that has been inflicted on them. They can end up treating it as if it's a virtue, as if it's something to be embraced, rather than a problem.
Well, basically, we consider that in some sort of sense, the left was retreated from the public space, from the terrain, during these social movements across Europe, as I think in others, you had the students' movement in UK, and also in Italy, and Greece, let's not forget that Greece is a particular case, and there were some different conditions apply there. But I think there was a genuine withdrawal of the left from the space in order not to be conceived as sectarian or as hawks who come in and try to kidnap movements. How do you think, or how do you evaluate the fact that this kind of springs of movements across Europe, I mean, had their points of increased resistance and disobedience, and then they kind of slowly retrieved or ended up without a significant effect, or as you say, without inflicting even a single damage to austerity. And then now, can we expect that after this kind of easing or kind of retrieving of social movements and social protests across Europe, can we expect that there is kind of a space for the left, for different structures on the left to take on, and in this middle time to build alliances with whatever structures have been left still alive of these social movements to kind of either incorporate them or build large-based social alliances in order to try at least to provide for a leftist bloc in different, I'm aware that there are different contexts throughout Europe, but might this be a moment which the left might attempt to use in order to build such coalitions and such blocs?
Yeah, I should correct myself. There is one instance where austerity has been defeated, an austerity government implementing a savage austerity measure, and that's in Quebec, the province of Quebec in Canada. Now, you could argue that belongs to a different cycle, it belongs to the cycle of student protests from the 2000s, possibly. However, it was an explicitly austerity-led measure, and so the question is, to answer your question, how did they win? Because they did win. I mean, it was a provisional success. You know, it's susceptible to being rolled back, and there's all sorts of problems. But in the immediate term, well, you can look at what they did. I mean, the student movement there did have an infrastructure. They had a long tradition of building up direct democracy. They had real organization on campuses. So it wasn't like in the United Kingdom. I don't know what you have and what your experience is in Macedonia, but in the United Kingdom, the National Union of Students is effectively turning itself into a lobby. You know, it does precious little for students. It's not really a democratic institution. There's, it's very difficult to be involved, and its most directly political role is to catapult certain ambitious and attractive young students, well, not always attractive, into the role of a Labour Party candidate for the election. And this is, you know, maybe you have the same sort of experience, but in Quebec it was different.
In the Conservative Party for the moment, in the left
party. Oh my God, it's okay. See, I never thought that we in the UK could actually pity the left somewhere else. All right, so they had forms of direct democracy. Not only that, but they set out to build social alliances. They went out looking for alliances with organized workers. Now, they could not get the trade union bureaucracy to actually call strikes and stuff like that, but they could mount solidarity actions with workers who were on strike. They did get some dough out of the trade union bureaucracy, which is not nothing, you know, and they won over working class people in their communities. You know, you had the famous pots and pans protests of working class people coming out in the streets at night bashing their pots and pans. I don't know what, you know, but the point is that it basically signaled that people were powerfully opposed to it. So the government upped the stakes consistently and they sent the police after them. Now, here's a question. At that point, do you try to appease the forces of law and order? Do you try and appease the media? Because in just as in the UK, you know, we had this problem. When the government says your protests are illegal, it's not just a threat of violence. There's a strong normative and ideological pressure not to protest. You know, so the student movement in Quebec said, no, fuck off. They organised, not only did they refuse to tell the police where they were going to be marching, they sent the police an image of their route, which was shaped roughly like that. And essentially they, I mean, I'm not suggesting that people should, I'm encouraging this people. But I am saying that their disregard for how they would be received by the media, how they would be received within the consensus of law and order, meant that they were able to go on and continue to wage a militant struggle, which in the end, you know, the government bet everything on the election results, and in the end, actually, the government lost in quite a serious way. It didn't just lose because of the organization that the Parti Québécois, you know, the left nationalist grouping, whatever. I mean, they were pretty pathetic. It was actually the government's base split because it was totally incapacitated by the student movement. So its base split between two different parties, one ultra neoliberal and so on. So what I would say is, for us, we didn't have anything. I mean, you know, I mean, I don't want to overstate, and I know not everywhere is like England, but generally speaking, the infrastructure of social movements is much more depleted. So that when social movements come up, you know, they're always going to dissipate. That's going to happen. This question is, what residue do they leave behind? What traces do they leave? Do they leave any forms of institution that can be capable of sustaining ideas and strategies and certain discussions through difficult times, and that can help propel new movements towards success? And generally speaking, they don't, and this is a problem. So therefore, I propose three strategic orientations. Okay. One, these are all a process of reconstruction, and they take time. They take maybe a generation or so. One is the rebuilding of the sort of basic grassroots from below infrastructure that makes it possible to have a successful social movement. And by that, I don't mean, you know, having a think tank or something like that. I mean building in communities on issues that come to ordinary people. In the United Kingdom, in working class areas, you can build up campaigns against the so-called bedroom tax. I don't know if you've heard about this.
Yeah.
Okay. You can build up campaigns of tenants who want to oppose rent increases. You know, these are local, very issue specific, but they bring people together in a way that neoliberalism prefers to keep them apart. Okay. So you can, if you can find spaces like that where you can actually get people to together a much larger and wider layer of people than those who are explicitly politicized and who know that they're politicized. Second, I think is you need a reconstruction of that symbolic space within which a left alternative is feasible and means something, because of the, you know, I mean, it's not just 1989 and all that. I really think the classical model of socialism has utterly collapsed. And I don't mean to say that we can just therefore forget about it. We cannot. It's, you know, it's something, it's our legacy, I think, we're on the left, and we'll have to assimilate it and figure out what went wrong. But there's a traditional three-legged vision. There is the ideological sort of normative goal of socialism. And there's a general view about what socialism is, whether it's state control or workers' control or something else. There's a long-term strategy, whether it's reform through the state or sort of revolutionary overthrow of capitalism. And then there's the agency that's capable of implementing it, usually the working class. I mean, all three of those layers, I mean, have been attacked and weakened. And I don't think it's just something that's happened since 1989 or even since the 1970s. I think it's something to do with the post-war period and the collapse of what used to be called the vanguard, you know, the self-organized layers of rank and file workers and so on. So I think rebuilding that space means building in a space that is being vacated, and that is where the social democracy used to be.
Yeah, this was basically my next question. Basically, you talk about the failure of the social movements to leave traces in the sense of social institutions behind them. And on the other hand, we have the traditional social democracy, the reformist left, which is dramatically failing apart all around Europe. And here we have an established institution which is breaking down. And we talked earlier, do you consider that the left has the capacity to address the kind of base, the social base of the old, of the reformist social democratic left, without turning itself to more, moving itself to more to the right in order to accommodate their already established traditional political views? Or do you think that also the crisis period makes it possible to address this kind of social base or the failing institutional social democracy with the argument that has been built in the radical left, let's say, without any attempt to move to the right in order to accommodate this, which still is a certain significant number of population?
I would say it depends what you mean by being pulled to the right. I think that it depends also on the conjuncture of the social formation, also. But for example, in the United Kingdom, left unity is well to the right of where I am, but I'm a member of it nonetheless. And the reason, I think, is because if you want to relate to people to who are essentially ordinary people who have always voted Labour. You know, they've got certain ideas, they believe in public services, they believe in nationalising key industries, banks and so on. You know, I mean, these aren't hugely radical things, but they're well to the left of the mainstream consensus, and they are alienated by the neoliberal direction of the dominant Social Democratic Party. Well, you know, this is you need to somehow effectively mediate between where you'd like to be and where things actually are, and you need to somehow find a structure that can mediate between your maximalist revolutionary goals, and where the people you want to talk to are at the minute. So I think the radical left formations that have been emerging are not, you know, the fact that they did start to emerge in the late 1990s and 2000s is not accidental. It has to do with the defeats obviously inflicted by on the left and the labor movements in the 1980s and in the wake of the collapse of the USSR and everything, and the collapse of the ideological horizon that represented. So that has opened up a space in which it's possible to build radical left organizations. But we can learn a lot from the successes and failures thus far. One model we definitely don't want to imitate is that of the Front d'Action Communiste, right? And the reason why it was such a disaster is not just that they, you know, it's not because they were to the right or anything like that. They're often quite radical, I mean, in principle. It's because they joined a government that was neoliberal. They joined a neoliberal government and they implemented neoliberal policies.
The next election they feel
devastated. And you know, this is exactly because they destroyed their whole historic purpose. Then you know, there is the model of Syriza, which is focused.
Where I wanted to add to. This is the model of Syriza, which basically has expanded some enthusiasm not only in Macedonia but throughout the Balkans, but. The way in which have the Syriza have managed itself through the political process has brought up a sense of dissatisfaction and demoralization with the easing of their rhetoric as they went inside the political process, they went in the elections, and now the latest polls show that they are the first party by supporting Greece, and basically they are a government in waiting. It seems that they have slowly shifted to the right in order to accommodate the different challenges that the political process offers to them. And this, would you see this model as a viable model for the similar parties in contrast to Rifondazione Comunista in Italy?
Well, we don't know what. We are only at the beginning of a pedagogical process. What I would say about Syriza is two things. First of all, I've spoken to a number of Syriza members, and their perspective when I spoke to them was that the majority of the membership of Syriza prior to the election had not really had to face up to the idea of what would you do if it was between sticking with austerity or leaving the European Union. So they were able to go with this slogan of not one sacrifice for the euro, although in practice it was quietly dropped before the election. But this was the, you know, this was the idea. You know, they were able to slightly shelve the whole question of discussing the EU and the European the Eurozone. Since the election and the campaign of economic blackmail that was waged by the EU's rulers in order to prevent Syriza being elected, the pressure has all been on Syriza to move to the right in order to not be seen as damaging to the country's economy and so on and so forth. And the majority of members, faced with this issue, have decided, actually, you know what, we'll stick with the Eurozone. For all the sacrifices that are necessary, we'll water down the anti-austerity commitment rather than break with the commitment to the Eurozone. And I think that's a fundamental weakness, and I think it's a problem. But it's not something that can be overcome with exhortations or propaganda. It's something that I think you have to win by fighting within the organization or working alongside members of Syriza. So, is it a successful model? Well, you know, we've yet to see, but I suspect the successful model is yet to emerge. The other thing is that there's the materiality of the state to bear in mind. I mean, there's a right-wing Palancian interpretation of the state, which is essentially, in my opinion, a bastardized version, which basically leads you to the conclusion that if you get allies within the state, if you work on certain fissures within the state apparatus, you can gradually convert it to a socialist kind of state. Eventually, you know, we'll get there, somewhat down the road. And this is an argument for a gradualist, reformist, and conciliationist project, which basically means that you end up with opportunistic measures like Syriza aligning with the independent Greeks. The sort of left Palatsianism, which I think is more correct, at least more correct than the right one, is that it requires the creation of crises within the state apparatuses and crises within the power block, and therefore you have to, and that has to be induced by serious antagonism. And the problem is that Syriza is pursuing, you know, I have no idea whether it would be effective for them to try to create some sort of crisis within the state, but I know for sure that there's not going to be any positive result from them tempering their analysis and watering down their commitments. And the problem is, of course, that once they get elected, which is quite, you know, quite possible they will, that the most, I mean, the people who will be reformed will not be the state apparatus, it will be Syriza.
So basically, earlier when we talked, you said one of the viable ways is not to choose between this binary of acting within the state, or basically even if a socialist revolutionary party takes power through elections, there would be a lot of sectors and segments within the state administration which would work against it if there is no process of generating a crisis within the state apparatus through which a certain reactionary segments would be cleared off the apparatus, but then also maintain a level of political activity, struggles, and engagement outside of the state. I consider this to be one of the ways to move forward, because it offers the alternative of basically increasing the activity in certain issues, in certain areas within the alternative states, out of system methods, through possible alliances with social struggles or with the base. But another issue that we got is that the sudden rise or increase in popularity in Syriza does not correspond with its social base. And basically, do you think this is kind of a false image of such a radical party, still radical left party, which might crumble if they don't succeed to build up alliances with social struggles in order to sustain such an electoral support? Because I believe that the danger is that if the support for Syriza crumbles dramatically, that will kind of be a negative example for similar parties, at least in the neighboring countries, or similar drives, and basically it would kill the idea of such a party.
I think it's a feature of the conjuncture. I mean, given the generally depleted state of the left, given the absence of the infrastructure that I was talking about, it does become quite easy for, well, not easy, but possible for comparatively small groups, and certainly there are smaller groups in Syriza, but for comparatively small groups, if they intervene at the correct point with the correct slogan, to suddenly acquire huge influence in the situation. I'll give you an example that's perhaps not as contentious as Syriza. In the United Kingdom, when the student movement kicked off in 2010, and when I say kicked off, I mean that there actually was a student movement as opposed to there being nothing. The major sort of organized grouping that was doing anything and setting the dates for protests and where they would be was a small group of people from a couple of far-left organizations, which are absolutely minuscule. They're marginal. They've got no social weight at all. But they launched a couple of front campaigns, and they set up a Facebook page. And these kids were coming from poor, outer London suburbs just by responding to what was on Facebook. And that was the influence they had. And the result of this was that the leader of one of these crops was a guy called Michael Chesson. He came to believe that if he called a protest, he could have summoned 50,000 people to the streets of London. I mean. But essentially, this is you know, this is the sort of situation, the conjunction that we're in. There's always going to be the inherently fragile situation until we reconstituted some of that structure. Syriza is definitely a perilous situation. That does offer opportunities, though. And one of the things that you can say is that if Syriza were to win, you know, there would be pressure on them to sort of try and quiet down their base, try and sort of keep struggles under control and so on. But if they did have a base in the trade union movement, if they did have a serious relationship with several trade unions, like, I mean serious, like the, you know, in the way that the KKU has historically done, or the PASOK, you know, I mean, if they were able to do that, they would have been much more success in cracking down on struggles. So the weakness of their relationship to social movements and to trade unions and so on might actually be a strategic opportunity. To bear in mind.
You mentioned two issues that I would like to focus a little bit more before we go to the next and then a bit later. We're open for questions. We'll have a question and let you know that. Basically, you just mentioned the trade unions, and we've seen the decline in trade union activity and trade union revolutionary politics throughout Europe. And the same thing even worse. I mean, we talked about the trade unions. We even had to protest in front of trade unions because they don't use protest and because they have been occupied by the unions elites, which are in tight cooptation with the current government structure, or whatever government or whatever party is in government in the country. It seems that when you talk, I get the sense that you're kind of advocating for a more wider approach to social movements, which means that in the context of past war, we should not only focus in the unionized workers in the current unions, mm-hmm. but we should use wider struggles which spring throughout different issues and try to bring in the class rhetoric or the class argument inside the struggles. You believe that it is still possible to politicize and to mobilize the trade unions and the unionized workers in alliances with the left, or they should be considered as one of the many social actors and other social formations and social movements with which we should work with. Or we should, basically my question is, should we still maintain the classical Marxist political praxis of insisting if only the working class, the unionized working class, also having in mind that we have a cross-section of the workers which are not unionized and are out there. So what do you consider is viable, or do you think that there is still a potential for a very revolutionary politicization of the trade unions?
Yeah, there is that potential, but I mean, I think we have to, when we talk about the working class, the reality is, I don't know what the situation is in Macedonia, but in the United Kingdom, of all private sector workplaces, 90% have never seen a trade union representative. Truth is that most working class people have never seen a strike, never seen a picket line, don't know what it's like to be in a trade union or what benefits you get from it. So there's, you know, a real historic disconnection there. Even though the trade unions in Britain remain the largest single social organisation, I mean, they've got something like 6 million members, you know, it's not, they're not insubstantial, but they're very specialised, they're very particular to certain public sector areas of occupation and a little bit of manufacturing. So my answer to you would be that we need, first of all, yes, social movements in order to bring together the broadest possible range of the working class. I mean, when we talk about slogans like the 99%, the 99%, we know it's not 99% of people who are against austerity or whatever, but it's a populist slogan. But one thing it does establish is the idea of the overwhelming working majority. And it's the overwhelming working class majority that we need to somehow pull together. And since the trade unions are not capable of doing that, and since the majority of people have never seen a trade union, and since neoliberalism has restructured the space of work in such a way as to make trade union, it's actually made trade unionisation very difficult. Obvious thing to do is to find ways of organising unorganised workers as well. And I think that's another part of the long-term reconstruction project that I'm talking about. I think you have to be going to, and we should look to examples where this has been successful. In Bolivia, they found ways to organise people in trade unions who had been smashed before by starting up trade union recruitment in town centres. You know, they reached out to people in local communities rather than relying upon trying to get to them in very small, isolated workplaces. So, you know, there's strategies and tactics that we should think about here. That's a long-term objective. The other thing about this is that there's three levels that I think we need to be reconstructing at. There's the social movements, there's the left of social democratic type of organisation. There's also revolutionary recruitment and revolutionary reconstruction, because what has the idea of a fundamental challenge to capitalism has been germinally, nascently reborn a little bit with the anti-capitalist movement, with the subsequent Occupy movements and so on. But they're still very nebulous, very diffuse. So I think there is a need for a process of rethinking. Thinking through all the debates and arguments of the 20th century and working out what is still valuable and what is not. But also of working out how is it appropriate for us to organise in this day and age, because I cannot believe that the methods of organisation that were appropriate in the era of the mass print press was relatively new, mass literacy was relatively new, before the era of the television, should be the same as that obtains today in the era of the internet and mass self-communication has not become the norm. So that's another part of the, I think it's a progressively narrowing in focus, but I think they're all essential parts of the reconstruction process.
You mentioned a bit earlier on the relation of Syriza to the euro and to the Union and the Eurozone as such. And from several authors, not only coming from Greece but also from the European Union, you've seen some kind of resistance towards the European idea, to the idea of European Union, and to the continuous, especially from quite overtly expressed left-wing and radical left-wing authors in Greece, who have come up with the idea of leaving the Union, leaving the monetary union, and defaulting on euro, defaulting on their debt. But the thing is, usually in Macedonia, we talked a little bit earlier, the larger section of the left, of the people who consider themselves to be leftists, let's be correct in this, they still don't have a structural, in a sense, left in Macedonia. But the sentiment is usually pro-European, for the reasons that we talked a little bit earlier, and these are conditioned by the regional setting that we do. Most of our countries are quite small countries, and at least if not European, we would need a sort of a regional federative tendencies, a regional design policies in order to have some sustainable and effective long-term social improvement. But then you've claimed that the savior, simply because it operates through the neoliberal logic and the last night you mentioned, the European Union is an example of the victory of the project of the bourgeoisie.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think your problem, the one that you're addressing, is a real one. It's it fits within the Gramscian problem of the game. And by that I mean, the question is one of organising the working class, the subaltern class elements and so on, and disorganising the ruling class. And the problem is that at the moment what you have is when there's a social struggle, when there's a question of privatisation or austerity, who comes to implement it? If you're in Greece, it's the IMF and the European Union. It's the European Finance Ministers and the European Central Bank. They are organised at a European level. But when someone has to resist, who resists? But it's not the European working class, it's the national working class. In other words, the problem that we face is the fact that the European Union is based upon the successful organisation and to a degree a kind of political centralisation of the European ruling classes in a sort of hierarchical structure. While maintaining the disorganisation of the European working classes. So, I mean, one thing that you can see underpinning the whole process of Europeanisation, the convergence of currency and so on and so forth, is the development of what sociologists call an interlocking directorate. That means that companies are increasingly sharing directors across across different companies, and that is expanding across Europe. So you've got this network of firms, large transnational firms across Europe, which effectively depend upon one another for supply chains, for expertise, for a certain purview of industry, and they form the basis upon which the political institutions, I think, of the European Union are formed. Labour, organised labour, the working class, is by and large excluded. I mean, you know, it's occasionally incorporated in some of the very junior apparatuses of the European Union, and then only on a consultative basis. The democratic institutions of the European Union are extremely weak, and that's by design. Increasingly, what's happening, therefore, is that the European Union forms, and its institutions, forms one of the ways in which the electoral potencies of national elected bodies are taken away and delegated upwards to the federal European level. And this has the effect of seriously restricting even the limited choices within any parliamentary democracy. Now, the question is, can you somehow occupy the EU? Can you get into those apparatuses? Can you join the European Union and hope to get elected to European institutions and get your man, maybe get Cyprus in one of these institutions and thereby hope to reform it? Well, I would say that if you think a national capitalist state is hard to reform, the European Union is going to be way, way worse, because its susceptibility, its vulnerability to pressure from below, from the working class and from subaltern groups, is much, much weaker. It's far more self-consciously and institutionally a ruling class project. So I think it's doomed. And you know, I mean, not you know, obviously I can understand the difficulties, but I think, I mean, you said two things. One was the Europeanisation as possible answer, or a regionalisation. But actually, I don't think those two ends are in conflict. It's just the Europeanisation of the labour movement and of the left and so on can be institutionalised in various ways. It doesn't have to take the form of being in favour of the expansion of monetary union, which, if implemented, the result of which is that, you know, you're going to have a fiscal straitjacket imposed on any state that participates in it. And, you know, quite probably the imperialist structure of the system will mean that you know, you're going to have German capital and Dutch capital and so on battering down the doors to get your, you know, get them to lower your wages and so on. But they'll need you to buy their stuff, so you're going to have to borrow a lot in order to buy their stuff. And eventually, at some point, you're going to find you can't pay the debt, and they'll say, lazy bastards, they can't pay their debts. You know, so, I mean, you're going to end up in a sort of Greek dilemma, I think, if you go down that route. And it's, you know, it's surprising that more countries haven't found themselves in that severe a crisis, but I'm certain that they will.
Now we're open to taking the questions from you. The first question pops up. I just one last question, comment before we take the question from Zafko. And that is on the relation of the rise of certain groups on the other side, let's say of the far right, and especially tendencies of their mainstreaming into the political process through their electoral victories throughout Europe, where we know that the most blatant example is the rise of the Golden Dawn in Greece. You said that you don't see kind of direct causality, full-fledged causality between crisis and austerity and the rise of the far left. What do you think that the new left throughout Europe, which are the crucial political and social points that the new left in to kind of provide for a social setting which would make it impossible for this far and radical right support in the social space?
There is
the phenomenon itself, what do you think is the causality of a failure, of, if it's not a failure of a neoliberal system, of what it is?
There is a causality, it's just not this simple and unmediated one. I mean, I think there is structural causes and there are conjunctural causes. It's the same thing with Syriza, actually. I mean, the parties of the radical left have been developing for a long time, and then you get the credit crunch and the crisis, and then you get the implementation of austerity, and that opens the space in which Syriza can grow. They've been growing. The Die Linke had been growing, you know, so it wasn't new. Same thing with the far right. You know, if you want to look at the far right, the growth of far right parties across Europe, in Belgium, BNP in Britain, the various far right parties, the Nordic far right parties, profiting by and large from the collapse of the sort of traditional social democratic sort of voting blocs. I think you can see that they have roots in something else. Now, there was an old Trotskyist analysis which said that fascism is a chemically pure distillation of the culture of imperialism. And what that means, in effect, is that if you really apply that analysis in a serious and systematic way, the culture of imperialism today is totally different than it was in the 1930s. In the 1930s, you still had colonialism as the dominant world system. You still had white supremacy built into the global system. Anti-Semitism was a dominant norm of those imperial blocs. The far right of today is far the imperialist culture of the radical right in America. And if you look at someone like Breivik, where does he get his ideas from? He gets his ideas from the libertarian right think tanks in America. And this is so you can see that there are various crises going on. There's a crisis of the collapse of representation, of representative democracy under neoliberalism. There's a crisis of work which makes it possible in certain formerly industrialized areas for struggles to take on a racial dimension, which then means that the far right can profit. There's the crisis of imperialism and the fact that the United States undertakes an extremely risky, adventurous project of trying to remake the world under the Bush administration, and pioneers this projects a new kind of Islamophobic articulation, and that becomes the dominant form of racism on the far right. And it doesn't look like the traditional determinist, somatic kind of racism. It's very culturalist and so on. So the causes, the causality, I think what you have is that a crisis opens up breakdown of the traditional institutions, the breakdown of traditional forms of political authority, and where that breakdown of authority is most severe, and where the crisis of representation is most severe, and where the state apparatus is most log-jammed. I think Palacios is right about this, to foreground the role of the crisis of representative institutions. That is where other institutions, the institutions of the far right, come in, and they substitute themselves for the apparatuses, the repressive apparatuses. This is what happened in Greece. You know, the Golden Dawn effectively became the police for some people. You know, you called them up, they said, I've got a problem, I've been burgled, call the Golden Dawn. And you know, they would come around and beat up some immigrant for you. This is the sort of, you know, I think that's the relationship between the two.
Is that the best question?
First, I want to express my pleasure to listen to this discussion in Macedonia, because it is unfortunately quite untypical. At moments I was listening to this discussion, so rare it is, but it was quite informative. I have one question and one comment. My comment is about Syriza. I'm a little bit optimistic towards the situation with Syriza. It doesn't mean that if they took a more moderate rhetoric, more modest when they are on government. Sometimes it is a struggle so not to scare people, to be less radical in order to win the government. When you are on government, this is a tough, then you have the power implemented by a series of rightist parties, and it should not be thrown away. And maybe, I say maybe, I'm not sure that Syriza is doing that, but we will see how our Greek comrades will act. So it is a strategy maybe, and I am hoping that it is. Second, it is a question, that question concerning Syriza is unfortunately too far away from Macedonian circumstances. So I will to talk about a party who can win the power and to implement leftist agenda. You have mentioned NGOization of leftist policies as a pathology of the situation of the left. I would agree with that analysis, and I wanted to ask you about your opinion, how to fight this this pathology, because we have that problem a lot here in Macedonia, in such measure that people are afraid even to be a member of an organization. And when you speak about forming a leftist party, they see you as a devil of some kind.
Okay. There's another question.
Okay, so.
If you don't listen, present
yourself. Okay. Aphrodita, and. my field is like education and arts in particular. So my question is, you mentioned that we need to rebuild this space that is left after the collapse of socialism and that had been occupied by social democracy. But my question is, how to rebuild this space? In particular, what methods to use? And also, how to avoid the objection of acting neoliberalistic in the sole approach or thought or attempt to organize disorganized groups such as social workers. So this is one question regarding the rebuilding of the disorganized in this case. And the second one, it really sparked my curiosity. I'm not familiar with this kind of the social movement you mentioned, but it was really interesting to hear you say that it had been like simulated. And this reminded me since I got asked, obviously, what is your opinion coming from a like slightly different discipline? What would you say about art interventions in the sense of like in public spaces and not in terms of long-term impact, just generally? And I have an example on top of my mind about an art intervention. I don't know the name of the artist, but it was in Germany. A German artist simulated, made art by placing a huge container of rubbish in the middle of the square, putting people inside, and other people around them like were just reporting what was happening inside, and that was called the Big Brother. And the people inside were presented as immigrants who were, you know, gradually kicked off from this container as a metaphor, kicking off immigrants from the country.
Okay, two things very quickly. First of all, about Syriza. It might be a strategy, right? It might be that they are moderating their rhetoric and that they, once they get in government, they will have the power. The problem with that is, of course, if you do that, and if you're dependent upon a popular base, well, you've immediately lost a lot of your popular base once you come, actually, we lied, we're going to go much further. And then, you know, you risk creating a crisis for yourself. And given the arrangements of power within Greece, the media, the state apparatuses, and so on, would have a field day. They would take that government down. And that brings me to the other side of that, which is that you said the right has used this strategy, and you're right, I agree with you. They've been very effective at this. The problem is that the state apparatuses, the materiality of the state is such that it is far more amenable to pro-capitalist, pro-neoliberal uses than it is to the uses of the radical left. Such that if you go in there with a strategy of not trying to offend anyone, of trying to get coalitions going, once you get in there, you're up against tremendous resistance from people who are far more powerful and far much more of a problem for you, an immediate problem for you than the voters, because you know you've only had to talk to them, you know, for a couple of months before the election. Now you're going to talk to the civil servants. Now you've got to talk to the inner troika, as Syriza calls it. Now you've got to talk to those who basically organise the state when there isn't an elected government, and who they are congenitally hostile to your goals. Not only that, you've got to talk to business, because it's business who you're going to be taxing if you want to fund anything. And it's business who are going to be withdrawing their money if they don't like what you're doing. They can go on an investment strike. Now you've got to talk to the European Union's leadership. You've got to find some way of not alienating them. You've got to talk to Obama. And this accounts for this curious dance that the Syriza leadership has been doing. They've been trying desperately to say the right things. If we can send out the right signals, yes, we're going to try and pursue a project of social justice. No, don't be frightened. We're not going to offend your fundamental interests. You should actually be in favour of us, because only we can deliver a real solution to Europe's problem. Austerity can't deliver a real solution, and so on and so forth. The problem with this is, of course, they've misunderstood. And, you know, Obama, Merkel, and all the rest of it, they're not that bothered about a solution to unemployment. They're not that bothered about a solution to social instability. I mean, it's a pain, but they're bothered about a solution for the banks, because ultimately, for them, the banks are at the centre of any growth strategy. They're at the centre of any sort of future for expanded European capitalism. They would be quite happy to have a government implement socially catastrophic policies, policies that will result in considerable political instability, provided they can actually get away with it. And that's what they've proven. So even if it is a strategy, I think it's one that's likely to fail. I think that the resistance to any attempt to move to be too radical once they get in would be overwhelming. I think that they would either have to put up a hell of a fight against the entrenched power of the state and of international capital, of European capital, and so on. In which case, who would be their allies? They'd have to turn around and say, actually, now we want to mount a fight to implement policies that we didn't tell you we were going to implement, but now we're going to implement them, so will you support us? They would meet the social movements, they would meet the workers, and the problem is that a large number of people who vote for them say, we didn't vote for you to do this, we voted for you to implement the moderate policy and to cuddle up to Washington, you know. So I think it would be a strategy that would collapse in, you know, incoherence as soon as they got in, even if it's meant in that way. And to be honest with you, I don't think it is just a strategy. I think they've decided that better something than nothing. I think they've decided that for Greece to get kicked out of the European Union, or rather of the Eurozone, would be so catastrophic. You know, that the only alternative being offered, as far as they can see, is some sort of Cuba in the Mediterranean. You know, some isolated little balkanized enclave. Trying desperately to implement humane policies, but basically would have to be quite an authoritarian and unpleasant state to actually do anything, to actually produce anything. So they've decided, I think, to accept the European Union and the Eurozone's sort of dominant policies, and to try and mediate between where they want to be and, you know, where the European leadership actually is. How to fight the pathology of NGOization? I wish I had the time to lay out a complete strategy for this, but I think the general thrust of it has to be two things. First of all, people always prefer the real Armani. If you've got a social movement that really resonates with their interests and which really is about, you know, something that has to do with an urgent need of theirs, then you will have much more chances with withstanding the attempts to hijack and to control things by small, you know, unrepresentative groups. The more you can build up some sort of grassroots democracy, something from below, the better chance you will have of that becoming a durable and sustainable thing. The problem is that, you know, it's trying to find a way to mediate between the fact that we don't have much of an infrastructure at the moment, and that we ourselves are small, unrepresentative groups, you know. And therefore, for us to be able to reach out to people and to help people build the kinds of connections and sort of social structures and infrastructures and democratic forms of organization, we would have to avoid being that kind of manipulative kind of organization, or even being seen as such, because obviously people would smell a rat right away. So we have to somehow be implanted in struggles, implanted in movements, and, you know, very much part of them, but respecting their specific ecology, respecting their needs, and participating as co-equals rather than as people who want to somehow control it. So this is, I mean, it's hard, and it's a long-term thing, and I don't think it can be done in a couple of years. I think that this is a long-term project. But I do definitely believe that if you commit to such a strategy, you can start to see some. And the other thing was, how do you? How do you rebuild this the space, and what's the method? And second, in terms of the symbol of the social movement. Okay, how do you rebuild the space of socialism? I think I would be in favour of building up radical left organisations wherever possible. And radical left means somewhere between traditional sort of social democratic reformism and the partners of the revolutionary left. I think they are, in effect, in the language of 20th century, centrist blocs. And I think that they are organizations where a debate can happen, where the answers are not known by everybody in advance. Because, you know, the thing about revolutionary socialist organizations, necessarily to some extent, is that there's a great degree of ideological homogeneity. So it's very difficult to have a process of rethinking and reconstructing when everybody already knows the answers. So I think that these are spaces in which it's possible for some sort of dialogue to take place. But also, I think that they are, this is linked to my previous answer, they are, if they are able to, with appropriate humility, embed themselves in the labour movement, in the environmental movement, in the feminist movement, among students. You know, if they're able to do this in a way that says, we don't claim to speak for you, we don't claim to dominate you, we don't claim to own you, but we want to be with you, we want to work alongside you. And at the same time, if in that organisation's policy thematics and its dominant ideology, it is able to concentrate the expressed interests and social goals of the various groups that it is implanted into, I think over time you will build up that symbolic space. Finally, just very briefly on the question of public art and so on and so forth, I would just say that this works very well in some cases. I've seen examples of it, provided it is not seen as the thing that's going to make the change. The problem is that we have this notion of protest as being fundamentally communicative. Now, it can be communicative, it can be about sending a message, to use the cliche of neoliberal democracy. But actually, more often than not, protest is supposed to be disruptive. You know, when they come on the news and they say this protest was disruptive, it's supposed to be! That's the whole point! You want it to disrupt people's day, you want it to disrupt business, you want it to disrupt the streets. You know, the idea is to say, we contribute to the functioning of this system, we make it work, and if the system doesn't work for us, then we're not going to cooperate with that anymore. We're going to stop cooperating. You know, it's like the old slogan, lead follower, get out of the way. When somebody says that, I obstruct.